405. Would you turn with me, please, in your hymnal? 405, a friend I have called Jesus. Let's all stand together, please. A friend I have called Jesus, whose love is strong and true, and never fails to wear his tread, no matter what I do. I've sinned against this love of his, but when I knelt to pray, confessing all my guilt to him, the sin clouds rolled away. It's just like Jesus to roll the clouds away. It's just like Jesus to keep me day by day. It's just like Jesus all along the way.
Singing. Good to see you back in church tonight. Looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us this evening. Let's start with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, thank you for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for each one that has made their way back to the service tonight. And Lord, we bow before you here, and we want to thank you for what we just sang about. Thank you for your great love for us. And you so loved us that you gave your only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And so, Lord, we're thankful for your great love for us, and we only love you because you first loved us. And so, Father, we pray that you'll be pleased with our service tonight. We pray that you'll use it, the music that we sing, that it'll be a praise to you and a blessing to you as we sing with grace in our hearts. And, Lord, I pray that you'll use the fellowship together of the people of God and use your word once again in each of our lives. Give each individual what they need tonight, as only you can do. And I'll thank you in advance for what you'll do. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
443 in your hymnal, 443. There is sunshine in my soul today, more glorious and bright. Let's sing that first all together. There is sunshine in my soul today, more glorious and bright than glows in any earthly sky.
Can hear the songs I cannot sing.
Announcements for us now. Listen carefully if you would. Right after service tonight, the couples that work in the children's church, I need to have a meeting with you in the conference room. Just be a few minutes, but we need to go over a couple things with the last couple months coming upon us here the year, and we need to take care of that. So right after service for the junior church workers in the conference room, if you would. And then regular schedule this week. Tuesday night for the Grove City School of the Bible, Wednesday night here for the midweek service, continuing our study on the armor of God, doing the spiritual warfare. Wednesday night at 7, we have the RU inside down at the prison on Thursday night. We have the RU program right here at the church on Friday night. Had, what did we have, 37, 38, something like that here on Friday night. Had a great crowd, and Lord's doing good things. Then Saturday, our soul winning and bus visitation at 10 a.m. as usual. We'll begin a little bit of a head start, getting some flyers out for the dinner day coming up November 13th. They're here, and we're going to get ready to get that launched for Operation Saturation. Next Sunday evening at 5:45, we'll have an important organizational meeting, get everybody together on that and get prepared for that big day on November 13th, okay? And give you some incentives and some things that are going to be good, that will be a little different, new for us for this coming year, that I think you'll want to hear next Sunday night, all right? Don't forget the Saturday night, the hayride and bonfire going out to the Manning Farm. If you haven't signed up, sign up for that, and make sure you remind yourself what you're bringing. If you have any of those chairs, you know, and put in a bag, you know, things like that, don't carry a folding chair with you, okay? Just but if you have a chair like that to bring, that'll help as we sit chairs around the bonfire, okay? That's a great time. So I hope you plan on being here. If you're going to want to ride the bus down, you're welcome to do that. It'll leave the church at 4:15 sharp, okay? So that'll be this coming Saturday for our hayride and bonfire. All right. Now, let's take just a moment and let's welcome any guests we have with us tonight. And Brother Mark down here has a guest with him. Who do you have with you, Mark? That's great. John, good to have you tonight, brother. Thank you for coming to church tonight. Good to have you. Leanne, you have somebody with you tonight. Another Leanne. Well, all right, great. First Leanne and second Leanne here. All right, good. Good to have you. Great. Leanne, delighted you're here tonight. Thank you for coming. That's great. All right. Anybody else here tonight for the very first time? I don't think so. If you'll be kind enough to take a moment and fill out the welcome card, we appreciate you doing that. In a little bit, when we have the offering go by, just put that card in the plate if you would. And please keep the pen as our gift to you for coming tonight. We're glad you're here. Let's give our guests a warm welcome, shall we?
Thank you.
264. Would you turn with me, please? He is able to deliver thee. 264. We're going to sing the first and last together. On the first, 'tis the grandest theme through the ages rung. 'Tis the grandest theme for a mortal tongue. 'Tis the grandest theme that the world e'er sung. Our God is able to deliver thee. He is able to deliver thee. He is able to deliver thee. Though by sin oppressed, go to him for rest. Our God is able to deliver thee. 'Tis the grandest theme. Let the tidings roll to the guilty heart, to the sinful soul. Look to God in faith, he will make thee whole. Our God is able to deliver thee. He is able to deliver thee. He is able to deliver thee. Though by sin oppressed, go to him for rest. Our God is able to deliver thee. Amen. That's good. 542. 542. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word. Let's all stand together one more time. On that first together. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Ladies, let me hear on that second. Oh, how sweet. Together now. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him. Men on that third. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease. Just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior friend. Let's sing that last together. When we'll get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out on that last. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior friend, and I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
All right, everybody said? You can be seated. Thank you for your good singing tonight. Ushers are coming. We'll get our offering now this evening. We're going to pray tonight for our offering, but I want you all to remember the Messer family in prayer. Most of you know Fred and Sherry. Fred's sister, Angel Messer, they found her dead this afternoon. And she's younger than Fred. And just went to wake her up, but she was already passed. And so I got that message. So please pray for them. Pray for the family. Pray that they'll be able to minister to the family during this time. And God's grace will be sufficient for them. Okay? Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. And Lord, as we lift up the Messers to you tonight, we thank you so much for Fred and Sherry, Christian and Emma, and the blessing they are to our church. And Lord, we're asking for special grace for them as they go through the loss of his sister. Lord, we do not know her spiritual condition. And Lord, I'm trusting you'll use Fred and Sherry to be a great help and a comfort to the family during this time. And Lord, I pray you'll use it as an opportunity for others to be drawn to Christ and to come to know him as their Savior. Lord, just minister to them and help us to know as a church family what we can do to help and to be a comfort and to be an encouragement to them during this time. Lord, I pray that you'll wrap your arms around them and strengthen them as they go through this trial. And Lord, we pray your blessing on our giving tonight. Thank you for how you've helped us and prospered us. And I pray, Lord, that you'll bless both gift and giver alike this evening. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Take your Bible this evening, if you would, please, and go to the book of Job. Job chapter 23. Job chapter 23. Once you get Job 23, I want you to pick up also 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4, if you would, please. After we read Job, we'll turn over to 2 Timothy 4 and read just two verses from over there, all right? But Job chapter 23, We are going to read verses 8 through 12, and we read them responsively as we normally do. Begin together on 8, and I'll read 9, and we'll alternate till we end together on verse 12. And then we'll turn over to 2 Timothy and read two verses there. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin on verse 8 of Job 23. Ready? Behold, I go forward, but he is not there, and backward, but I cannot perceive him. On the left hand, where he doth work, but I cannot behold him. He hideth himself on the right hand, that I cannot see him. But he knoweth the way that I take. When he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. My foot hath held his steps. His way have I kept and not declined. Neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. And then over to 2 Timothy chapter 4. I'd like to read verses 6 and 7 and read them together if we can, starting with verse number 6. Ready? For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Now, Father, add your blessing to the reading of the scripture here this evening. I'm asking you, Lord, that you would continue to prepare our hearts and make us ready to receive your word here this evening. Thank you for each one that's here tonight, Lord, and I pray that you would help us to focus now. Use the special to help us to get our mind, our concentration upon you, and Lord, ready to receive the truth you have for us from your word this evening. Bless the special to that end, I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Never moves without purpose or plan. When trying his servant and molding a man, give thanks to the Lord, though your testing seems long. In darkness he giveth a song. Oh, rejoice in the Lord. Mistake. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. For when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold. I could not see through the shadows ahead, so I looked at the cross of my Savior instead. I bowed to the will of the Master that day. Then peace came and tears fled away. Oh, rejoice in the Lord. He makes no mistake. He knoweth the end of each path. See, testing comes from above. God strengthens his children and purges in love. My Father knows best, and I trust in his care. Through purging, more fruit I will bear. Oh, rejoice in the Lord. He makes no mistake. He knows at the end of each path that I take. For when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold.
Now, our Father in heaven, we bow before you as we come to the preaching of your word tonight. And Lord, I'm asking for your help as we look at the scripture here this evening. And Lord, I ask for the help for the people as they listen tonight. Lord, I pray that each of us would have ears to hear what the Spirit would say to his church this evening. Lord, we're thankful that it still pleases you through the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. That you in these last days have chosen to manifest your word through preaching. And I pray you do so tonight. Once again, honor the preaching of your word. Use it in each one of our hearts. Help us to mix what we hear tonight with faith that it will be profitable in each one of our lives. And help us to be able to finish well. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can have your Bible open to Job 23. I'm going to reference Paul to begin with, but we're going to look at Job 23 together this evening. I don't think anybody in the Bible would be more tested or more afflicted than what Job went through. We oftentimes, whenever somebody's going through a hard time, we'll compare them to Job and say, well, I don't have as bad as Job had it. And if there's a New Testament, but I think if there's a New Testament counterpart to Job, it might be the Apostle Paul. When you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and starting about with verse 23 through 28, and he lists all the things that he went through, the beatings, the imprisonments, the being night and day in the deep, and fastings, and perils by his brethren, and perils by false brethren, and all the things that Paul went through, and yet he kept on going for God. In fact, what you read tonight in 2 Timothy chapter 4 is the last book, the last chapter, and some of the last verses that God would ever have him pen before he gets his head chopped off. And so he tells Timothy, his son in the faith, the one who's going to come up and sort of, Paul, I'm sure, praying he'll kind of take my office when I'm gone. And he tells him, I'm ready to be offered. I know the time of my departure is at hand. And he says that great verse that I've fought a good fight, I've finished my course, and I've kept the faith. Boy, that's a great statement. I don't know about you, but if they could put that on your tombstone, you'd be a very blessed individual. To know that you fought a good fight, you finished your course, and you kept the faith. I'd love to finish well like that. To finish that, listen, to be able to say that at the end of your life, I'll guarantee you something. You're going to have to go through some trials. You're going to have to go through some trouble. You're going to have to go through some difficulties. You're going to go through some personal battles. You may go through some financial battles. You may go through some marriage difficulties. You may go through some health issues. You may go through some friendship and relationship problems. Job said that man that is born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. As the sparks fly upward. Okay? True statement. And so you realize you don't have to be you don't have to be much over 12 years old to realize you're going to life's going to have some rough bumps in it, and some twists and some turns and some difficulties. And when you go back to Job 23, if your Bible's open there, you may feel like Job did. Notice what he said in verse 9, or in fact, verse 8, I go forward, but he's not there. Who's he? Yeah, God. Saying, look, I'm going forward, but I don't see you, God. So what does he do? The natural thing is I'm going to look backward, but I don't perceive him there either. So I look on my left hand where I know he works, but I can't behold him. He hideth himself. Job said, here I am, I'm looking all over for God and I don't see him. What do you do when you don't see God? What do you do when you look at your life and say, man, I just don't see where God's working? And I don't see him anywhere. I don't see him in it. It seems like God is hiding himself from me. How do you get through those times and not throw your hands up and say, I quit. I give up. There's nothing to this Christianity stuff. How do you get through that time so that you can get to the end of your life and say, I fought a good fight, I've finished my course, and I've kept the faith. How do you get through those times and end well? I want to help you tonight to end well. Let me ask you a question tonight. How many in this room are 35 years of age or older? Let me see your hand. Yeah, that's probably 80% of the crowd, almost 90% of the crowd. I'm not trying to be a discourager, but your life's half over. Okay? If God gives you 3 score and 10, you're in the second half of the game, okay? Now, I realize some of us are in the fourth quarter, amen. But and some of you might be in the last 2 minutes, I don't know, but I hope not literally, but it's very possible. And so we understand that if the Lord may be gracious and give us more than 3 score and 10. And that's great. And praise the Lord for that. But I want to be able to get through the hard times, get through the tough times, get through the trials, and finish well. Finish well. I see three things here, three principles to follow if we are going to end well. And number one is this: determine that the trials will make you better. Determine that the trials of life will make you better. Look at verse number 10. He knoweth the way that I take, and when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. The modern version of that is I wish it weren't true, but I'm fearful that most Christians today would say, and when he had tried me, I'll come forth a nervous wreck. When he hath tried me, I'll come forth a mess. Or when he hath tried me, I'll come forth a bitter person. But the truth is, you ought to say, when he's tried me, I'll come forth a better person. He didn't say, he says, I'm not going to come forth with my faith shaken. I'm going to come forth as gold. Determine to be better. Determine that you're going to be better by the trial. You know, nothing can ruin you but you. You can blame it on other things and blame it on other people and blame it on other situations. But Jesus said there's nothing from outside a man that can defile a man. It's only what we allow to defile us. Only what we allow to ruin us. We don't have to let the trial ruin us. Job didn't say, I hope to come forth as gold. Job didn't say, I'll try to come forth as gold. He said, I shall come forth as gold. I don't know about you, but that's determination. That I will come forth as gold. I think of Lee Robertson, who pastored the Great Highland Park Baptist Church for years in Chattanooga, Tennessee. For over 40 years, he was the pastor there. An amazing, amazing work that God used him to do in those days. You understand, for 40 consecutive years, he baptized for 40 consecutive years at least 1,000 converts every single year. Not for 1 year, not for 5 years, not for 10 years. For 40 consecutive years. Billy Robertson, when he was just a young preacher, away preaching a meeting, got a phone call from his wife that their 2-year-old daughter, firstborn, named Joy, had passed away. Lost a 2-year-old daughter. He had to come home and conduct a funeral for his daughter. You see, he had to get through a trial. He had to get through the hard time. He had to get through I don't want to have to experience that. Some of you have been through that. Some of you have gone down. Some of you have gone through that deep water. I hope I never have to experience losing a child, especially losing an infant child. But Lee Robertson came forth as gold. They sang tonight about Ron Hamilton's song. Ron Hamilton wrote that song as he was in the hospital with an eye tumor, a tumor in his eye, and they were going to take him into surgery at Emory University in Atlanta, not knowing whether he'd come out with his eye or without his eye until they actually did the surgery. And of course, he came out, they had to take his eye, and so he had one eye. And in one of the cards, the many hundreds of cards he received, and it was that verse, Job 23:10, when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. And that's the basis for which that song was written that they sang tonight. He came forth as gold. He started a ministry, and a little child came up one night. He had to wear a patch over that eye for a while after the surgery. He was leading music at Southside Baptist Church in Greenville, South Carolina, and a little boy come up to him. Maybe it was either after service or it was during one of these handshaking times like we do. Little boy came up, as little boys can, and they say, "Hey, you look like a pirate." And Ron Hamilton said, "I guess I am. I guess I'm Patch the Pirate." Because he had a patch. And that started the Patch the Pirate songs and the Patch the Pirate clubs and all the music that my kids grew up on and many of you grew up on when you were kids if you grew up in a Christian home. And now even your children can be growing up on that. All because he had to get through a trial. And instead of getting bitter, and instead of getting upset, and instead of becoming shaken in his faith, it strengthened his faith. And he came forth as gold. Some of you are familiar with Lisa Beamer, the wife of Todd Beamer. He was on the airline that went down in Pennsylvania. You remember during 9/11? He was the one who made famous the saying, "Let's roll." And they charged the hijackers, probably saved buildings in Washington, as they believed that plane was probably heading for some of the buildings in Washington, D.C. But she explains how she was reared in a loving home where the Lord was honored. And she goes on to say, on October 25th, 1984, pain seared through her father's chest and everybody thought he's having a heart attack. The next morning at 5 a.m., the doctor called her mother to tell her that her husband, Lisa's dad, had suffered an aortic aneurysm. And a small hole had developed in the wall of his aorta. It had to be repaired immediately. Mom explained to Paul, Holly, and Lisa, the three children that the hospital called, the doctors were going to have to do emergency surgery on their father. She said, "They're going to move Daddy to another hospital. We need to pray." She said, "We got dressed and we were all kneeling in prayer. And it was a little after 6 a.m. when we were in the process of praying when the phone rang again and Mom left the room to answer it. When she came back in, she blurted through tears, 'They tried to move Dad, but it was too late. He died.'" She said, "In that instant, my world fell apart. I wasn't ready for this. I was 15 years old. I felt cheated. Dad was our foundation. Dad was the rock we depended on. Now he'd been ripped out of our lives." In her own words, she said she struggled with her father's death. She said, "My faith in God was severely shaken. Questions pummeled my heart and my mind. Life went from wonderful to a sense of great vulnerability. We had our faith and we believed solidly that God had everything under his control, but the hole in our family was very real." She said, "Despite our faith, sometimes life just hurts." She says, "I recall the promise that God made through Jeremiah, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." She went to talk with Dennis Massaro, who is the director of Wheaton College Office of Christian Outreach. The subject of an upcoming trial for a malpractice came up, and she immediately told him of her father's story. Dennis kindly told her, "You know, Lisa, God knew the hospital they were going to take your father to did not have the right equipment to perform the surgery. At any time, God could have changed the circumstances." He continued to tell her, knowing what the consequences were going to be for your family and for you, he nonetheless allowed that to happen. "Maybe it's time for you to accept that." She said, "His gentle words were a real target, a real arrow right in my heart. I knew he was right, She said, at the same time, I loved him and I hated him for telling me the truth. But the truth set me free. A thought struck me, she writes. Who are you to question God and say that you have a better plan than he does? You don't have the same wisdom and knowledge that he has or the understanding of the big picture. You think you deserve a happy life and get angry when it doesn't always happen like that. When in fact, you're a sinner who deserves death. All at once, I was caught in a dichotomy. I know I'm really important to God and he truly loves me, but at the same time, I'm a mortal and I have limited understanding. Who am I to question him? And she said, it was in that moment I made a conscious decision to stop questioning God and start trusting God. Boy, that's a great decision. She said, that brief conversation with Dennis Massaro would become one of the most significant in my life, replaying in my mind over and over in the years to come. And it especially came back to her September 11th. 2001, when she lost her husband, Todd, in that plane crash. You see, the loss of her father at 15 was only a preparation for what was going to happen 17 years later when she'd go through the loss of a husband. God was simply preparing a woman to be a testimony to a nation and maybe to a world on September 11th. Determined to be better by the trial. Determined to be better. Determination. Let me give you statement number two. Principle number two. Decide to keep on doing what is right. Decide to keep on doing what is right. Here's Job. Notice again verse 11. Job says, my foot hath held his steps. His way have I kept and not declined, neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. I've esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. Job says, notice my foot held his steps, his way I have kept, I've not declined at all from his way. And by the way, that follows when I don't see God anywhere. That follows when he says, I think God's hid himself. I mean, all this stuff has happened to him. His friends have come in and they're going to talk to him and tell him all the things that's wrong with him. And they're going to be miserable comforters. And Job is saying, yeah, you know what I do when I didn't see God and I look behind me, he's not there. I look ahead, he's not there. I'm not seeing God in anything right now. You know what I did? I kept doing what I knew was right to do. That's what I kept doing. My foot kept his ways. When I don't understand, when I wonder what's going on, when I can't see where God is or what God's doing in my life, what should I do? I should keep doing what I know is right to do. What did he do? I think he kept on praying. I think he kept on reading his Bible. I think he kept on going to church. I think he kept on being faithful to his Sunday school class. I think he kept on singing in the choir. I think he kept on being an usher. I think he kept on being kind. I think he kept on helping others. He just kept on doing what he knew was right to do. The temptation when trials come or difficulties come into our life when we're not seeing God at work, we're not seeing what he's doing, the temptation always is to drop everything. Well, I'm going to drop my class. Well, I'm not going to be in the choir. Well, I'm not going to be at church tonight. I'm not going to... And we tend to just back off from everything. Can I help you? That's not the way you'll finish well. That's not the path to finish well and to finish the course. You quit Sunday school or you quit helping others or you quit going to church and you quit praying and you quit with reading your Bible and you become a used to Christian. Oh yeah, I used to do that. Oh yeah, I remember when I used to. And fill in the blank. It can be any number of things. And it's all about not what you do, it's what you used to do. When obedience is most difficult, it is most necessary. When obedience is most difficult, it is most necessary. thinking of Paul and Silas when they got arrested and thrown in prison there in Philippi. Now remember, why did they go to Philippi in the first place? Paul wanted to go into Asia, and the Spirit said, no. So he waited. And while he waits, he has a vision, a dream, if you will, and there's a man from Macedonia saying what? Come over and help us. Man, I'm sure Paul woke up and said, hot dog. I don't know if he said hot dog or not. He's a Jew. He might not have said hot dog, amen. But kosher dog, maybe, amen. And hey, he said, somebody wants our help. Come on, fellas, let's go. And he takes off for the chief city of Macedonia, which is Philippi. And when he gets to Philippi, he can't find anybody. No men at all. Somebody says, well, there are some women that meet down by the river. And so he went down to talk to the women. But there was one woman there named Lydia, whose heart the Lord opened. And she received Christ as her Savior and her house. Then they had some other problems there in Philippi, and they began to be persecuted, and they ended up getting arrested for preaching. Now, how many of you would have said, God, wait a minute. I thought they wanted help over here. And we're in stocks, and we've been beaten. And we're in stocks, we're in prison. But the Bible says in Acts 16, I think in verse 25, at midnight, they prayed and sang praises to God. And the other prisoners heard them. I ask you a question. Would you have felt like praying and singing praises to God at that point? Or might you have been having a little bit of a pity party for yourself? Than what I signed up for. Beat up and put in jail. Come on, God. Why are you doing this to me? They were praising God. They were praying and rejoicing. What were they doing? I believe with all my heart they were doing what they knew they were supposed to do. I don't think they felt like doing that either. I believe they knew, listen, what should we do? Well, we ought to pray and thank God. And we ought to sing praises to Him. That's what we're supposed to do, so that's what we're going to do. I'm not going to go by my feelings. I'm going to go by what I know is right to do. And because they did that, God heard their cry. God heard their singing. God sent the earthquake, and everybody's bands and the chains fell off, but none of the prisoners escaped. God did all that so Mr. Jailer could come in and say, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And so the jailer could get saved, and Mrs. Jailer and all the little jailers. And they got saved and got baptized that night. Then he washed their stripes and tried to take care of them. God did all of that. See, sometimes we just get focused. God, why are you doing this to me? Why is this happening to me? God, what's wrong? How come? And the truth is, if you just would keep doing what you ought to be doing, keep praying, keep being faithful, keep being a witness, keep singing praises to Him, God's going to use that to influence somebody else to come to Christ. Never would have happened if they'd have been complaining. Never would have happened if they'd have been griping in jail instead of praying and singing praises to God in jail. So what do? Got an argument at home? What should you do? Come to church anyway. You have a hard day at work? What should I do? Come to church anyway. What should you do when you're having a hard time and the relationship's falling apart? You read your Bible anyway. You continue to do what you know you ought to do. You stay in the book. You lose a loved one. You have a tragedy. What should you do? Stay in the book. Keep praying. Keep telling others how good God is. Be in church. Just continue to do what you know is right to do when you don't feel like doing that. Because your flesh will tell you, forget it. Don't go there. You don't want to be around people. Stay away from everybody. See? That's a lie of the devil. Don't listen to that. Decide, I'm going to do right no matter what. Everybody here has met somebody. along the way who isn't in church, isn't serving God, who used to be in church, used to serve God, used to live for Him, and they're not doing it now. And they'll point to somebody or something that happened and say, that's why I'm not going. That's why I quit. That's why I don't think there's anything to it. You see, they somewhere along the line, they didn't ever establish the fact, I'm going to be determined to keep going no matter what. Doesn't matter what anybody else does. Remember Sunday school this morning? Peter was all concerned, what about John? What's he going to do? Jesus said, what is that to you? Follow thou me. Jesus said, you're following me. You're not following John. Don't you get worried about what John's doing. I'll do with John. He says, if I want him to live till I come back, what's that to you? That's what he's saying. He's saying basically, he really was rebuking Peter, saying it's none of your business what God does. You know what? It's none of my business what God does with another one of his children. God doesn't have to consult me. God can do what he wants with his own children. And so I'm going to be determined that I'll be better through the trials. I'm going to decide that I'm going to do right no matter what. And then let me give you principle number 3 this evening. It's in verse number 12. Desire to meditate in God's word. Desire to meditate in God's word. Verse 12, neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. He didn't say, I treat your words as my necessary food. He said, I treat your words more than my necessary food. That's a big statement. Big statement. We set times to eat. And oftentimes we eat whether we're hungry or not. We eat simply because it's time to eat. It's breakfast time, it's lunch time, it's dinner time, and it's sit down and we eat. The truth is, you ought to set a time that you're going to read your Bible, study your Bible, memorize your Bible. You ought to set that time and then do it whether you feel like doing it or not. You'll never read your Bible every day until you read it on the days you don't feel like reading it. And let me help you. Don't think that everybody feels like reading their Bible every day. I'll confess to you. There's days I don't want to read the Bible. Oh, I'm leaving church. Well, you just being honest. You know what? This is flesh on me just like it's flesh on you. That's not the issue. The issue is, will I get up and will I read it anyway? You see? It's the discipline that will allow me to access that which can make me spiritual and have a relationship with God. So I'm going to set that time to be in the Bible whether I feel like being or not. You know why? That book will change me. This book will change you. Books, you can read other books and it's good for your information, but this book is for your transformation. This book will change you. It's like any other book you have. There's no other book that will impact you like the Word of God. No other book that is given by inspiration of God. No other book that has been breathed out by God. These are not the words of men or the words of a man. These are the words of God. The Word of God is quick. It means it's alive and it's powerful. And it'll accomplish unbelievable things in your life. Just as sure as you need physical nourishment, you need spiritual nourishment. I expect when I go to get my car repaired, I expect the mechanic to know something about my car. If you go to the doctor, you expect the doctor to know something about medicine. If I go to see a lawyer, I expect the lawyer to know something about law. If I go to an insurance agent, I expect him to know insurance. Is it too much to expect a Christian to know his Bible? Christian to understand God's book? We read the Bible, but you ought to go beyond reading the Bible, and the Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God. Why do you read the Bible? You read the Bible so you can begin to study the Bible. Why do you study the Bible? So you can memorize the Bible. You want to commit it to memory. The reason you want to commit it to memory is so you can meditate on it. The other night at the prison, one of the fellows asked about, I heard people say meditate. He said, I don't know what that means. And meditate literally means to think about it, think on it. It's the same word that is used of the cows when they eat the grass and it goes in the stomach. And then after a while, when they're just laying down in the field or sitting there, they'll just kind of bring it back up and chew it around in their mouth some more. Who wants to go get pizza? Amen. You know, and what he's doing is he's you know, you're chewing on that again. Sometimes somebody will say something to you and they'll say, yeah, chew on that for a while. What do they mean? Think about it. Think about that for a while. And so when you memorize God's word, the Spirit of God will bring that back to you. You know what you do? You meditate on that. Don't make the mistake of get up, read your Bible, close it up, and go off the rest of your day and never think about what you read the rest of the day. Don't compartmentalize God. Don't leave him in that place where you read. Take it with you. And the way you take it with you is through memorization and meditation. God has promised success and prosperity to Bible meditators. Joshua 1:8, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein. How often? Day and night. Why? That thou mayest observe to do according to all that's written therein. You know, you'll do it. If you're thinking about it, you'll do it. Why? Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Thinking precedes living. Thinking precedes doing. If you want to change the what you do, you have to change the way you think. And so you begin to think, and God says, you mayest observe to do according to all that's written therein, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. That's the only time success is mentioned in the Bible. It has to do with memorization and meditation of God's word. Got it? Meditating on God's word, and take it with you. Write it on the 3x5 card. Write it out on something and carry it with you. Put it in your car and carry it in your pocket or put it in your purse. Put it where you can get access to it. And when you have time, and all of us have time throughout the day when we're waiting on something or waiting on somebody, you pull the card out. Instead of looking over here and getting distracted over here and thinking about this or the radio or some other thing just grabbing our mind, why don't we keep our mind meditating on God's word? I desire to meditate, Job says. I want your word to be more than my necessary food. Now I want you to think about this. We said determined to be better through the trial. We said you decide to do right no matter what. And thirdly, you desire the word of God to meditate in it. Now think about what Paul said. I fought a good fight. Determined to be better through the trial. You know what that takes? It takes fighting a good fight. Second, I finished my course. What's that? Deciding to do right no matter what. That's how you stay on course. You just keep on doing what you know you're supposed to do. Don't waver. I've kept the faith. How do you do that? Desire God's word. Meditate in his word. You'll keep the faith. The chorus they sang tonight, oh, rejoice in the Lord. He makes no mistakes. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. And when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold. Let's finish well. By 7 p.m. on October 20th, 1968, at the Mexico City Olympic Stadium, it was beginning to get dark. The last of the Olympic marathon runners were being assisted away to first aid stations. Over an hour earlier, Mamo Waldi of Ethiopia had charged across the finish line. He won the 26-plus mile race. As the last few thousand spectators began preparing to leave, they heard police sirens and whistles through the gate entering the stadium. Everybody's attention turned to the gate, and a solitary figure wearing the colors of Tanzania came limping into the stadium. His name was John Aquari. He was the last man to finish the marathon in 1968. His leg was bandaged and bloody. He'd taken a bad fall earlier in the race. But instead of just staying out and giving up, he had it bandaged and he got up and he began to limp his way around the track. The crowd of the people that were left stood and applauded. He completed the last lap inside the stadium. When he finally crossed the finish line, one reporter asked a question that everybody had been wondering. "You're badly hurt. Why didn't you quit? Why didn't you give up?" Aquari, with quiet dignity, said this: "My country didn't send me 7,000 miles to start the race. They sent me to finish the race." And he's going to finish. Can I say it's the same way with God? I don't believe God sent His Son to die on the cross for us so that we could just start the race. He sent it so we could finish the race. I don't just want to start well, though I want to start well, but I want to end well. He didn't just begin, He didn't just die for your sins and have you accept Him as your Savior so you can begin a relationship with Him. He wants you to finish a relationship with Him. He wants you to grow in that relationship with Him. To start and to finish. Everybody here tonight, if you've been saved any length of time, if you've been saved especially probably over 10 years, you know people that aren't finishing. They've dropped out. Used to be in church with you on Sunday nights and they're not in church anymore. Used to talk about the things of God. They don't talk about the things of God anymore. They become casualties. Think about the Christians you knew when you first came to Christ. How many of them are still faithfully serving God? Don't take this matter of finishing well lightly. And the job is not to beat anybody else. The job's just to finish. Just finish. And finish well. Determine to be better. Fight the good fight. Decide to keep on doing what's right. Finish the course. Desire the Word of God. Not only to read it, but to study it, to memorize it, to meditate in it. You know why? Because you want to keep the faith. I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I've kept the faith. That's how you finish well. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth now this evening. Thank you for everyone's attention tonight. And Lord, this is such an important subject. Lord, there's some in this room tonight, I'm sure, that are just beginning the race. They feel like they've just begun to run a lap or two. Only been saved a short time. Others have been in the marathon. We've been running for quite a while. Lord, I pray that each of us are in it to finish. You didn't send your Son from heaven to earth to be betrayed in the hands of sinners and to take our sins upon Himself and die on the cross. Just for us to start the race, but for us to finish the race. And as we run this race, Lord, I pray You'd help us to understand we're going to go through trials, as Job did. We'll go through difficulties, hard times, deep waters, however we want to phrase it. But I pray, Lord, that these truths and these principles that we glean from the life of Job will be brought back to our mind by the Holy Spirit. We'll determine to be better through the trial. We shall come forth as gold. Lord, we'll decide we're going to keep on doing right no matter what. And we'll desire Your Word. Not just to read it, but to study it. to memorize it, to meditate upon it. We'd like our way to be prosperous. We'd like to have good success. We'd like to finish well. Help us to do that. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I'll finish praying in just a moment. Wonder how many believers here tonight would say, Pastor, the Lord has dealt with my heart tonight. I want to finish well. And these three principles tonight, God has spoke to my heart. And by His grace, I will remember them. And I want to practice them. I sure would like to say with the Apostle Paul at the end of my life, I fought a good fight, finished my course, and I've kept the faith. By God's grace, preacher, I really want to finish well. Here's my hand tonight. Pray for me this evening. Would you slip it up, Christian? Yes. Amen. Wonderful. You may put them down. Wonder if you're here tonight and would say, Pastor, I'm not sure I'm in the race. You see, you have to know Jesus as your Savior to be in the race. Maybe you're here tonight and you say, you know, I don't know that I've ever had a time in my life when I realized Jesus died for me. He died for the world, but believing He died for the world won't get you to heaven. You have to believe He died for you, died for your sins. And you must personally accept Him as your Savior and receive His gift of eternal life. Maybe you come in tonight and you say, well, Pastor, the Lord has spoken to my heart and I'm not sure that I've ever trusted Jesus as my Savior in the way you're talking about. Would you allow me to pray for you? I'll not embarrass you, will not single you out at all, but I'll pray for you. Would you slip your hand up tonight and put it back down and say, Pastor, pray for me this evening? Is there one like that tonight? In a moment, I'll pray and we're going to have our invitation. God has spoken to your heart tonight. I want you to respond to Him. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to hearts. Thank you, Lord, for decisions have been made tonight that I pray, Lord, will affect us for the remainder of our life until you come back for us, or we simply go through that gateway called death and we'll be absent from the body and present with the Lord. But Lord, whichever it is, we want to finish well. And so, Lord, hear the prayers that are made on bended knee at the altar tonight. And, Lord, remind us of these principles over and over again and help us to implement them, Lord, when they're most needed in our life. Please help each one to do what you've told them to do in their heart now. Hear our prayer, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, the pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this evening, will you?
I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus, who died upon that cruel tree? To think of His great sacrifice at Calvary, I know my Lord expects the best from me. How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when He has done so much for me? The hours that I have wasted are so many. The hours I've spent for Christ so few. Because of all my lack of love for Jesus, I wonder if His heart is breaking too. How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when He has done so much for me? I wonder, have I cared enough for others, or have I let them die alone? I might have helped a wanderer to the Savior, the seed of precious life I might have sown. How many are the lost that I have lifted?
How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me? No longer will I stay within the valley. I'll climb to mountain heights above. The world is dying now for want of someone to tell them of the Savior's matchless love. How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me?
Father, I pray that each day will find us doing our best for you. In your power, not in our power. In your strength, not our strength. By your grace and not by our works. Lord, I pray that you'll help us not only individually to finish well, but as a church to finish well. Again, Lord, we thank you for what you have done in these first 11 years. And if you tarry your coming, God, we look forward to what you have in store for us for the next 11 years. We pray you'll continue to help us to be faithful to you. And you'll continue to add to your church as only you can. Lord, help us to just do your work in the way you'd want it to be done. Now, Father, thank you for a wonderful day today. Dismiss us with your blessing and with your care. Make us mindful you go with us from this place. We love you, Lord. In Amen. Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated for a moment. As you well know, today is 11 years. When Pastor and Kathy came to Bible Baptist, remember 11 years ago, actually just a hair over 11 years ago, I came back to Bible Baptist, had recently left another church, and they'd changed some fundamentals, in my opinion. So I heard that Pastor Rock was back at Bible Baptist, and he had retired once, and then they asked him to come back, and so I said, going to go back there. I knew they didn't have a whole lot of folks there, but I thought that'd be good. So I came on a I believe it was a Sunday, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and then on Wednesday I came back and found out Pastor Rock had retired again, and I was just shocked. And he had recommended a pastor, an assistant pastor up in the Akron area. And begin candidating, gave with that strong recommendation the members here, which at the time were few, and if I am looking right, I believe the only ones that are here now that were there are the Wallaces and Andersons. I believe those are the only ones that were still here.
Carol Hoskins.
That's right. And it was, if I remember right, 13 people voted Pastor in, and Kathy. And I remember the first message I heard Pastor preach. It was a great message, but then he sang a song in the middle of it, a couple of verses of a song. I thought, wow, this is good. You get a preacher and a singer at the same time. And then I heard the next message he preached, and he sang a song in the middle of it. I thought, wow, this is pretty good. You get a pastor and a singer at the same time. And I had been 2, 3, 4 messages. I always had a verse of a song in there. And I thought, man, I kind of like this. But I had a wonderful opportunity to get to know Pastor and Kathy, maybe even more than the other members that were here, because I wasn't a member at the time. And so when they had their powwows, I don't know what they talked about in here, but when they had their powwows in here, I got to talk to them out in the fellowship hall. And I was single and had time and all that good stuff. So I got to spend some more time with Pastor and Kathy than others might have. So I have just grown to love Pastor, love Kathy. They're just a real dream when it comes to Bible Baptist Church. I was telling Pastor this afternoon, I counted 100 in the service this morning. That was after the kids left. And that's pretty awesome to see it coming from 13, 10 years ago, to now. Had to have been close to 140, 150 on the property today. And so that's pretty exciting. But we want to at least recognize 11 years. I don't know if that's more awesome for us that we have Pastor, or amazing that he's stuck with us this long. But Kathy, if you'd come, we have a card for Pastor. And flowers for Mrs. Slabaugh, Mrs. Pastor. She hates that. We really, really do appreciate it. And we just wanted to say thank you. Really, really appreciate it. Absolutely. So, yeah, there we go. Let's close with, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. All right, let's stand. All right. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in this army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Amen. You're dismissed.